Well, good morning, everyone. This is Ben Worrell with the Minnesota Department of Transportation. Today we're having a talk for our NRRA, National Road Research Alliance Research Pays Off series. And before I get into it a little bit, I'd like to just give a couple quick updates on NRRA. Again, our pavement workshop is going to be May 19th to the 21st this spring. The basic outline is online. The first day is going to be a day which we have a couple different workshops on intelligent construction, one geotechnical and one concrete workshop on that day with a MinRoad afternoon if those who'd like to go out to MinRoad. Then the second day will be more of the team activities. The teams, each of the NRRA teams, we talk and then a general session, then breaking out into team meetings in the afternoon. And the third day will be more of a traditional conference/workshop conference, I would say, where we have national speakers coming in to talk a little bit about what's going on and how they can best work with NRRA. So a good 3 days. It'll be at the Shoreview Community Center. That's just north of Minneapolis, St. Paul. So we're looking forward to your participation to the pavement workshop coming up in May. The second thing is the Geo Congress. We have a booth here that's gonna be held February 25th to the 28th here in Minneapolis. So we'll have a booth there for NRRA. If anyone visiting, please look us up at the booth and kind of go from there. But we're excited about the Geo Congress coming here to Minneapolis. And I guess the third thing would be is next month, Heidi Olson is going to be talking about partial depth repairs in our March research pays off, and that's on March 17th. I'll mention that again at the end, but we're looking forward to that because she'll be talking about different concrete repairs that you do that maintenance groups can do. So we're looking forward to hear the outcome of that because a lot of those patches are after they've been down for 3 years, we're starting to see some different trends in those areas. So Heidi will be going over that next month. But with that, I'd like to introduce Lev Skovanovich, University of Pittsburgh, and his team will be presenting on the evaluation of long-term impacts on early opening of concrete pavements. And basically, summarizing his talk, he's going to talk about some of the test sections we built in 2017 up at MinRoad, where we loaded those right after they were paved, much earlier than you would ever do on a normal job. Since it's a low-volume road, we're trying to look for any visible damage that occurs for that early loading with a semi and a pickup truck. They also did some really early loading where they drove across the road trying to cause some ruts in the concrete. So he'll be talking about all those impacts and if those impacts do produce some long-term damage and what he sees from the different instrumentation that's been placed out on those test sections. So with that, Lev, go ahead and give your presentation.
Thank you very much. Ben, you actually gave a really good preview of what I'm going to discuss in this presentation. But before, let me just briefly describe the objective of this project. As Ben said, we're tasked to evaluate visible, non-visible, immediate, and long-term damage caused by early loading of the MinRoad cells. Quantify the effect of loading damage on long-term performance, and it's ended up to be much more difficult task than it was anticipated. And finally, we need to come up with minimum strength at opening, and we envision it won't be just a time-based strength like 7 days, but it will be more involved like maturity or shear wave velocity based. And finally, recommend strategy for minimizing or avoiding the damage. So what the potential benefit of this project. We hope to reduce the total construction cost and time, like decrease user delay and improve user satisfaction, and reduce probability of premature failure. The majority of the states requires a minimum compressive strength of 3,000 psi prior to opening to traffic. I mean, that allows either 7 days or if the thickness less than 7 inches, then flexural strength of 500 psi, and it reduces the minimum strength with an increase of slab thickness. And this criteria seems to be quite conservative, and the mean road test data clearly indicate that these criteria can be relaxed. American Concrete Pavement Association has its own recommendations, and actually it allows the minimum flexural strength of 300 psi if there is a good support, or if the pavement thickness is greater than 8.5 inches. But even in this case, it is still quite conservative, and it's important to point out that the CPA in this table requires the minimum slab thickness of 8 inches. So if you go thinner, like it was at Mean Road, then the natural strength requirements will be much higher. So as Ben mentioned, in 2017, at the low volume loop, Mean Road built several test cells, and they were loaded at very early age, and one section was left as a control. All these pavement sections are 6 inch thick. They are doweled. They have a granular base, and they're built on a sand subgrade. It's important to point out that in this project, a standard concrete mix was used, so there was no early opening high strength mixes utilized. And the general objective of the study is to deal with the normal construction mixes and evaluate if the pavement can be open to traffic earlier than it's conventionally assumed. So the standard slab size of 12 feet by 15 feet was used. As I said, there was dowel in joints, and there were really, really early age loading. I'll show you on the next slide. So 2 hours after loading on cell 624, a vehicle ran across the pavement, and you can see a quite significant rut created by the tires. But it's important to point out that it created rut, but not cracking. And my understanding is, even up to today, the pavement still not cracked. In addition, on the same day of the construction, the cells were loaded by a snow plow truck and two axle pickup truck, and and first section 124 was loaded, and the section 124 was the section that was paved the last. So the vehicle load cell 124. After that, the loaded cell 124 and cell 224, 124, 224, and 324, and eventually all four cells were loaded, and cell 524 was left as a control cell. And as Ben said, there was no visible damage observed in the cells, and after that we evaluated strain gauge data and various other the performance indicator, and we tried to locate any damage that was caused by the early loading. And I can say up front that up to this point, we could not identify any effect of the slow loading. It's not because we didn't try hard, but every time when we thought that we found something, we would run checks with control cells or with adjacent cells, and we would have to reject that hypothesis. But well, I'll show several slides on this. So first of all, let's talk about strength data. They were collected by American Engineering Air and Testing, and they were cylinders and beams prepared on site and tested in the lab, and they were tested at various days from 1 to 7 in days, and maturity was measured at the same time. And here you can see development of flexural strength versus time in the lab, and compressive strength versus time in the lab. And you can see that several days after concrete placements, the flexural strength was above 500 psi, and the compressive strength was about 2500 psi. So flexural strength actually developed faster than compressive strength, and we know that in terms of cracking performance, flexural strength is much more important than compressive strength, and therefore this 3000 psi compressive strength criteria is quite conservative and actually can be relaxed. At the same time, they were measured maturity, which is a function of time and concrete temperature, and the strength maturity the curves were developed, and those curves allow us to evaluate the in situ strength of concrete, because naturally in place concrete exhibits a fluctuation of temperature, and the temperature affects the rate of hydration, and therefore in place concrete doesn't necessarily have the same strength as the concrete cured in the lab. So based on that, we related that the time of first loading, the compressive strength was about 100 psi, and flexural strength was about 90 psi. Here it's the first arrow should point to first maturity and the maturity of the first loading of cell 124 But you can see it's the strength is very low, and even up to this point, I can't explain why the cell did not fail. But well, the fact is it did not. But at the time when the last cell was loaded, like cell 424, the compressive strength was well reasonably appreciable with 1000 psi, but flexural strength was 320 psi, which is quite low. But as I said, no visible damage was observed. Significant portion of time we spent trying to evaluate strain data, and the cells were instrumented with eight sensors each. There were two pairs of longitudinal sensors located near the slab shoulder edge, and two pairs of transverse sensors located near the transverse joint. Not all sensors survived in the installation, and the quality of not all sensors is good, but we had enough data to evaluate. And one of the problems with the sensor measurements, especially the measurements at the early age, is that the data are noisy. And in the, about a year ago, I presented a simplified analysis we performed using some simplified denoising technique. But the last several months we spent analyzing the peak analysis, the program that was developed at the University of Minnesota, at the Electrical Engineering Department. And as you see, it, it helps to denoise the strain gauge data and identified identify the baseline, identify the peak values, but for some sensors, if the data too noisy, see the program does not provide any results, and this analysis we just ignore those strain gauges. So. In this presentation, I will present a comparison of longitudinal stress sensors near shoulder, and I'll talk about sensors 5 and 4. Sensor 5 located at the top, close to the top of the surface of the concrete pavement. It's about half inch below the surface, and sensor 6 located about half inch above the bottom of the concrete pavement. So, and you can see that even for July the 5th, so immediately, well, during the early loading, then there is no clear trend cell exhibits the highest strains, and basically strains in cell 424 that was loaded at later age than cells 124 and 224, well, at relatively later age and higher strength. But the strains are still quite comparable, so there is no real trend that early loading didn't put, would produce damage. It's important to note that sensors on cell 324 did not survive well the installation, and we didn't have too much data for them, so later on we didn't use their data. Now, the next round of strain gauge data was collected in November 2017, so several months after construction, and you can see that cell 424, it's like around dots, shows the lowest minimum strains, and for sensor 5, which is in the, which means that it's in compression, and sensor 6, which is which is the bottom, it's in tension. So basically, you can see that cell 424 exhibits higher strains, although it was loaded later than the remaining two sections. In March of 2018, there were like the sensor start showing low quality data, and you can but you can see that still cell 24 shows higher strains. And actually, it's another important important observation that it looks like in March the strains are higher than in other months, and at least it's higher than in November. And that agrees well with the mechanistic empirical PAME design guide models. That's, I was glad to see that at least something agrees with the theory here. But in this case, you can see that cell 124 shows the lowest in magnitude strains, and cell it followed by cell 224. And as I said, we don't have too much data for cell 424, but those strains are the largest in terms of the magnitude. And in April 2019, and the trends are not as clean as in March, but still we don't see basically any clear trend that the lower loading would result in abnormal damage. And after that, we didn't have enough data to compare performance of different cells, because not too many any strain gauges survived at that point. At least peak-to-peak program did not result in reliable data. Well, so far I talked about longitudinal joints, longitudinal strains. That's the mechanistic empirical PAME design guide considered to be critical. But very similar trends were observed for the transverse strains near the transverse joints. In this case, we compare sensors 7 and 8. And we can see that the magnitude of strains for cell 424, they're either similar with cell 224 or slightly higher. cell 124 exhibited the lowest compressive strains, and kind of in the middle of tensile strains. This is for November 2017, and quite similar trends were observed for March 2018. And again, self 424 loaded the last, showed the larger strains than cell 124 and cell 224. So basically, based on the strain gauge analysis, we can't conclude that early loading is actually very low edge loading caused significant damage, but it's one of the indicators we used. I already presented in the past that we analyzed ultrasound tomography data collected in the study. We evaluated shear wave velocity. These measurements were made on July 16, 2017. And we can see that shear wave velocity is actually varies in very narrow region, between 2.38 to 2.44 kilometers per second, and which tells us about good consistency of the data, and it means that there was no really weak spots, that the strength was lower. At the same time, we compared this shear wave velocity data with the data we collected at the University of Minnesota several years ago, and when we compared shear wave velocity with flexural strength, and based on that analysis, we evaluated that on July 6th, which means one day after placement, concrete strength was about 450 PSI, which is consistent with the maturity data we got from American engineering testing. Especially it's important considering that this plot was developed on a slightly different mix than in the lab, but it still means that one day after placement, the concrete strength, at least those mineral sections, was quite consistent, and the strength variability was quite low, and the strength data were in line with what could be expected, and greater than 450 psi. We also evaluated surface damage, using the methodology developed at the University of Minnesota several years ago, and we used so-called Hilbert transform indicator. It evaluates the change in shape of the signal sent by the ultrasound device, and in general, we assume that if the indicator is greater than 75, then there might be some potential damage, but usually if it's less than 80, we can say it's the damage is really minor. And here for some locations we did have certain spots with slightly higher damage. But first of all, it's important to point out that this indicator was developed for mature concrete, so we are not 100% sure that actually this slightly higher HDIs do indicate damage. And second, it still wasn't very moderate level, because here we show maximum locations, and only in a few places the damage was higher than 100. And what's also important to point out that there was no significant or statistical difference between this HDI indicator for the cells 124 to 424 and control cell 524. So even when we would just find the point and we would think that okay, that might be the damage, but after that we saw very similar scans from the unloaded cell, and basically we had to rule out that those high HDIs are caused by early loading and not just by variability in concrete. So basically, these conclusions are already presented in the past, but our conclusion was that ultrasound tomography did not locate any damage in the cells, but we are expecting to get new data and to analyze new data to collected more recently, and that will allow us to make the final, you know, determination if there is a non-visible damage and if there is difference between damage in the cells. But so far, we don't see any difference in damage from cell 5, 124 and through 424 and the control cell 524. We analyze falling wave deflectometer data, and we perform like the calculation. I will present only the results of evaluation of low transfer efficiency. And again, we can see that there is a low transfer efficiency slightly lower than I would expect for adult payment. But on the other hand, it's the same as in the control cell 524. So in this case, we can't say that whatever low LTE was caused by the earlier loading. And if you look at this cell 424, the lower LTEs for both in approach and lift slab observed not in the inside lane that was actually loaded by snowplow truck, but it's in the outside lane that was loaded by a much lighter the truck. So in this case, we have to conclude that we don't see any appreciable damage from the early loading in terms of reduction of the joint load transfer efficiency. And very similar observations could be made from the analysis of May 2018 data. Again, in this case, actually, even the difference in LTEs measured is smaller than from October 2017 data. We evaluated write quality data, and we saw that cell 124 is kind of slightly rougher than, let's say, 324 cell, but again, it's difficult to attribute it to early loading, especially considering that the cells are very short, and generally speaking, for IRI analysis to be precise, the length of the section should be much longer. You can see that naturally RI is kind of questionable for cell 624 where there is a rat. And my explanation of much higher RI for cell 524, but it's kind of still reflected from cell 624. I have to double check this observation, but if the measurements was done in direction of decreasing the cell numbers, that most likely the rough ride on cell 624 kind of demonstrated itself like in high IRI in 524 as well. But in any case, if you look at this data, the control cell 524 has a higher RI than cells 124 to 424, so we can't really say that early loading didn't cause reduction in write quality either. Well, so that brings us to the main objective of this study. It's just to explain if there is, why those sections are not failed and start developing recommendations on the modified criteria. So we performed quite a few ISLAP 2000 runs, and the main objective was to try to evaluate why the sections did not fail. And as I said, we still don't have a good explanation why FEL 124 didn't fail in the first run. It's we have some speculations, but not real proof. But generally speaking, it's for the rest of the cell, we built several models, and basically we model various levels of concrete Young's modulus, and here we can and we could observe that with increase in Young's modulus, stresses in concrete increase. So basically, if the payment was loaded at very early age, then stresses were lower than they would be when the concrete matured. So basically, there are two trends here. One is increase in stresses would increase in maturity, and the second increase in strength in increase in maturity. Fortunately, strength increases faster than stresses increase. So that's why loading later reduces risk of failure. But anyway, we also considered that. The data from the mechanistic empirical payment design guide, we simulated these payments using this tool. And in this case, in this slide, I consider the two loading cases. In this case, where we place the load 12 inches away from the edge, and we consider the actually a reasonably high effective temperature difference between top and bottom surfaces and 10 degree. And as I show later, usually it's lower. And you can see that actually the stress from slaughter is not extremely high. So they're in the order of 279 for the 12 kip load and 372 psi for 18 kip load. And we consider that this temperature gradient is quite high, and actually it's unlikely that that was actually happened in the, in the first few days after placement, and definitely less likely in the first few hours after placement. So basically, even these stresses are not extremely exorbitant, so the payment actually could survive this level of stresses. It's also important to point out that if the payments would be loaded exactly at the edge, then the stresses could be much higher even for the same temperature gradient. You see in this case, it's for 12 kip load is 420 psi, and for 18 kip load it's 540 psi. In this case, actually, if the payment would be loaded with 18 kip single axe load applied right at the edge, and if the temperature gradient would be, it just happened to be quite significant, then the payment could fail. But in this case, the load had to be applied right at the edge, and the stresses rapidly decrease when the load moves away from the edge. So that basically brings a very important observation. So if we need to open payment to traffic, it's a good idea to ensure that at least in the first couple days, the loads are not applied just at the edge. So basically just putting cones at the edge would be sufficient, especially if there is a if we have an asphalt shoulder, not a concrete shoulder. It's less critical for a tight PCC shoulder because it's unlikely that a joint will open significantly like in the first few days, and in this case the load transfer efficiency from the shoulder and actually will be quite significant. So in this case, even if the load is applied at the edge, it won't be as dramatic. We also analyzed, as I said, the internal data from the mechanistic empirical pavement design guide when we simulated mean road sections. What in one of the hidden files, they report equivalent temperature difference between the top and bottom surfaces. It's not an actual difference between top and bottom surfaces because there are some other nonlinear effects there. And for this, the maximum difference might be about like 24, 28 degrees, but because of some other factors, they act on the concrete pavement as about 10, 12 degrees. So you can see that the probability of very high temperature gradients, like from, let's say, 8 to 14 degrees, is not very significant. It's possible, so there is risk of those temperature gradients to occur, but it's more likely that the temperature would be around zero, which means the slab is flat, or even there would be some effective negative temperature gradients, and those negative temperature gradients actually reduce tensile stresses at the bottom of the concrete slab, and that reduces potential of of failure. We also performed an MEPDG type analysis for those sections. In this case, we assume 6-inch thick slab with the same joint spacing, and we considered like early loading with 1,000 trucks. And we computed fatigue damage. And just to give you an idea scale, if the fatigue damage is about 0.25, that would be considered like dangerous for pavement life. It's basically it's about 15% cracked slab with 90% reliability. So in this case, if we apply this 1,000 trucks on a pavement with flexural strength 400 psi, then this first 1,000 trucks will consume about 1/10 of the pavement life immediately. But in this analysis, we assume that kind of the track mix is the same as MEPDG default, and those defaults were developed based on the LTPP data for the interstate highway. And the next question was, what would happen if we enforce strict limit on the axle weight? So in this case, I limited 18 keeps the maximum load level for the single axle load, and 34 keeps for tandem axle. And you can see in this case, even for the flexural strength 400 psi, the fatigue damage was reduced like almost by half. And after that, if we limit the maximum load level for single axle load to 12 kips and for tandem 24 kips, then the damage would reduce even further. And here we assume that all this 1,000 trucks applied when the flexural strength is 400 psi, and it is reasonable to expect that the flexural strength will increase every day. As if you remember that in like 3-4 days, the flexural strength was above 520 psi, and this plot shows what to observe if there is a flexural strength 520 psi, and again, if there is no limit on the, so if we don't have a strict axial oscillate, then the damage would be still reasonably high, but stricter the limit on the axial load, less and less damage would be observed. And just for reference, we presented the results analysis for the flexural strength of 650 TPSI. You can see that this damage is much smaller. So basically what it means that if we want to open payments to traffic and earlier, it's also important to enforce axial weight restrictions, for example, for the residential streets, for collectors, it's important to keep garbage trucks out of the payment for several days, but I don't see any harm if passenger cars or light pickup or delivery trucks will operate on those payments, like 2-3 days after concrete is placed. At least currently, we don't see any negative effect on it. There is only one caveat to this conclusion. In this study, we did not evaluate abrasion resistance, and in this case, if we allow traffic to flow on the pavement, then it may remove curing compound quickly, and that will reduce durability of the upper, let's say, surface, and that cause abrasion and reduce friction. So it's important to maintain curing of the pavement even after open traffic if it is possible. So basically to reapply curing compound if it's possible. Well, so that's basically concludes my presentation. I think the mineral test data clearly indicate that the current early opening criteria are overly conservative. Otherwise, the payment would fail, but the cells 124-24 did not. So we also observed that the laboratory data indicate that the strength develops reasonably fast, especially flexural strength, and even 3-4 days after placement, the concrete flexural strength is reasonably high, like higher than 550 PSI. Compressive strength is still a little bit lower, but so the 300 PSI was reached after almost a week, but the flexural strength is more important than compressive strength. And we did see that high tensile strength measured at the early loading, but that could have an explanation. First of all, there might be not very good contact between strain gauges and the concrete, but there is another factor, is that the concrete stiffness was much lower, so that resulted in higher strains, but those strains at least did not lead to very significant damage. At least the strains at later ages were reasonable, and strain gauges in cells 124 and 224 lasted as long as, if not longer than in other cells. So we, although MinRoads data provided very useful, very important information, but we still need to develop mechanistic model, because they will explain us to explain. They will help us to explain why the payment did not fail, and will help us to extrapolate the data for other situations and develop rational recommendations for the new strengths and criteria, which I currently envision they will, like ACPA recommendations, and the current recommendations will depend also on the concrete thickness, but will also provide some ways to estimate it with the maturity of shear wave velocity. And finally, the preliminary analysis clearly shows that it's important to enforce axial load weight restriction if we open it to traffic, because that will significantly reduce the risk of premature failure. And in general, the early opening criteria that I envision today will be all about risk. So what kind of risk we're willing to tolerate, and what's the benefit of this. So we can't really eliminate probability of failure completely if we loaded it at very low H, because variability of concrete is high and many other factors might be negative. But on the other hand, it's, if we're willing to tolerate some risk, then the current criteria can be significantly loosened. That concludes my presentation. I will be happy to answer any questions you might have. Thank you.
Thank you, Lev. There is one question online. I don't know if you can see your conversation box.
No.
But there's a question saying, I'll read it to you. Is there a possibility of dowel bars moving under early loading, leading to a lower LTE and early socketing?
Yes, that's what we suspected first, but the problem is that the cell 524, which is a control cell, exhibited pretty similar LTEs. So we're still looking at this data, and we need to look more closely at in combination of LTE and transverse strain gauge data. So far we have not eliminated this hypothesis completely, but so far we've, at least let's put it this way, we were not able to find any evidence of it, but we tried to find it. And I agree with this, where the compressive strength might be important, the criteria for compressive strength is for bearing stresses on dowels. But so far our initial estimates show that when the flexural strength is sufficient, then sufficient for fatigue, then compressive strength is sufficient for dowel bearing stresses too. So it's a long answer to a short question, but.
Yep, that it is. Lauren, can you unmute everyone? There might be some noise coming up. We tend to mute people just so we don't get any feedback. But is there any questions from the group? Go ahead and speak up if you have questions. We have 6 minutes left here till the top of the hour. I guess, Lev, one of my questions I always wondered was, you know, we took so much care in trying to early load these test sections, and it didn't seem like we were able to get it on fast enough. How much effect did the temperature have on that? Because it was like perfect curing conditions, you know, for a quick cure, you know, when we built these in the summer. But if it was a colder, you know, how would that have affected anything would it matter?
Yes, actually, it's an excellent question, and again, there is no simple answer for that. On the one hand, because the payment was placed in July, and the temperature was high, and strength development was pretty fast, then that natural effect affected the results significantly. But on the other hand, the temperature gradients are higher in July than in other months as well. So actually, the worst month for loading is March, but the second is July if you analyze payment in mid data. So basically, there are two opposite trends. But coming back to your question again, it's the fact that it was in July affected the results in such way that if you load it after like 3 hours in October, that may cause problems. But if you load it for the same maturity level in October, I suspect the damage would be, well, I can't say lower because we didn't see any damage. But let's say you would not have a higher damage than this. So that's why the maturity measurements that were made by your team are very important to extrapolate.
Right, and we understood that.
Yeah.
And that's why we installed the maturity meters like Bernard mentions in his comments. Yeah. You know, we use those instead of time.
Yes.
One other question online is from Tumor. Is, do you think dull bar size will have an effect on our early opening strength?
Dull bar size, I don't think so. It was a 6-inch payment. So, I'm talking about this particular situation. Cells 424. If we go into other situations, yes, if you have like, let's say, 8-inch thick payment and 1-inch dull diameter, then bearing stresses are higher. And in this case, you might need higher compressive strength to prevent looseness. But that's again why it's important to talk about like maturity, tensile and compressive strength versus time of like physical time of opening, because compressive strength may develop at a different rate. But I agree with you. When we have the strength criteria in terms of dull looseness shouldn't put comparison with bearing stresses, not just compressive strength. Yeah, that's a point well taken. And bearing stresses depend on dull diameter.
Any other questions out there? With that, I guess we'll conclude. We do have a NWRA project page that covers this project we're doing. So if you have additional questions, I'm sure Lev will always be available to answer them. The technical advisory panel can bring them up also. But look at the website. Lev, how many more months do you have on this contract?
I believe we're supposed to finish by the end of the summer. But we're making significant progress right now in wrapping up data. We had to reanalyze some of the data because I didn't like the results. But we're making progress on analysis as well.
Okay. Yeah. So like this is one of the original contracted projects. So those will be done later this summer, and we look forward to the results. Finishing this up, I'd like to thank Lev for his presentation. Thank you, Lev. And we hope you can all join us in March again with Heidi Olson with Braun Intertech. We'll be talking about the partial depth repairs that were done out at Minroad with a number of different products in our old westbound. So with that, thank you, everyone, and hope you have a good day. Mm-hmm.